The next item of business is a debate on motion 9463 in the name of Michael Mara on a resilience fund for CalMac disruption. I'd be grateful if members who wish to speak in the debate were to press their request to speak buttons, and I call on Michael Mara to speak to and move the motion up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the motion in my name. The motion that we have put forward today has a simple ask of this government to establish a resilience fund for businesses affected by disruption and withdrawal of ferry services. How Green and SNP members vote at decision time tonight will be a clear signal as to whether they accept responsibility for their catastrophic failure of our island communities and whether they will take a small action to begin to make amends. But this failure has been 16 years in the making, but it is destroying livelihoods and communities today. The figures are damning. From May 2022 to April 2023, the Mallaig Lough Boisdale route suffered 79 diverted sailings, 142 late sailings and 296 cancelled ferries. More than one in four of all scheduled sailings never left the harbour. With news of yet more cancellations this month, the situation is, to quote Alistair Allen, MSP, abysmal. The consequences of these failures are devastating for islanders, with estimates that local businesses are losing close to £50,000 per day. In an already difficult climate of high energy and fuel costs, coupled with soaring inflation, businesses cannot afford further financial hardship. And between October 2021 and March 2023, CalMac paid £4.54 million in financial penalties. But where did those penalties go? The First Minister said last week that the money was reinvested back into the resilience of the network, and the government's amendment this afternoon reiterates that claim. But what is the resilience that they speak of? Hardly a week goes by without further announcements of delays and cancellations as the network rusts and breaks and the two ferries sit in port under construction in the west of Scotland. Their incompetent approach is not arresting decline or incentivising better performance. Precisely the opposite, Presiding Officer. CalMac bosses know that the money is being shuffled around, yet another SNP accountancy trick. In truth, island residents and business owners are the only ones to experience a true financial penalty as their livelihoods are destroyed. The idea of a resilience fund did not originate from these benches. It began in our island communities, when residents of South Uist gathered in droves to protest the withdrawal of yet more ferry services. Scottish Labour has spoken with business owners across the Western Isles, and their position could not be clearer. One business owner told us that the impact on her business was catastrophic and far exceeds the impact from the global pandemic, I quote. With this government, it is, I am afraid, Presiding Officer, a case of out of sight, out of mind. If 185,000 people, or a third of Edinburgh's population, was protesting outside the Parliament now, we know the government would have to listen. But when a third of South Uist's population turn out to protest, the government pays no heed whatsoever. No wonder that the owner of a catering company in South Uist told us, "We have lost all faith in the Scottish Government to be able to improve the situation." But that faith in government was not lost overnight. It is the result of 16 years of willful neglect of this SNP government, which leaves our islands facing an existential threat, Because this incompetence has consequences. Under the SNP, the vital infrastructure of Scotland's ferry services are reaching collapse. A litany of policy failures on infrastructure, connectivity, housing, education, fishing and more are leading to an exodus from our islands, particularly of young people who see no option for their future in the place they call home. The research paper, The Gaelic Crisis in the Vernacular Community, published in 2020, issued stark warnings about the future viability of the Gaelic language and culture beyond the next 10 years, in the face of an ageing population in island communities. The paper highlighted that, I quote, "the retention of young people and young families willing to contribute to community vitality will be central to any credible strategy of revitalisation." But how can we expect young people to stay in areas where they will be increasingly isolated and financially penalised? The very existence of Scotland's ancient language and culture relies on the economic viability of our island communities. But today it is abundantly clear that the SNP cannot be trusted with the protection of Scotland, of who we are and where we come from. They are eternally distracted, obsessed with press over policy, dissembling over delivery, and have utterly failed our islanders. So are SNP and Green members listening? Have they heard the cries of despair from our communities who rely on these services? And I see some members in the chamber who represent them directly today. Will you heed their calls for help? Given the government's position today, you must put aside blind loyalty to the amendment they've tabled, and that loyalty to a failing, incompetent leadership, and do right by your constituents. Have you heard their voices, and will you act?
Thank you. I now call on Mary McCallum to speak to and move Amendment 9463.2. Up to 5 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Before beginning, I should just like to welcome Fiona Hislop to post. She's bringing an enormous amount of experience to this role, and I'm really pleased to be working with her as Team Transport. On the matters in hand, I want to begin with a clear and unequivocal acknowledgement of the importance of the matters being debated today. For Scotland's island communities, ferries are not just a mode of transport. They are lifeline services, bringing food, vital supplies, and supporting economic activity. It follows then that these matters are not just about the improvement of transport service performance. It's about delivering confidence that's needed to sustain our island populations and ensure people and businesses can thrive. And insofar as Michael Mara rehearsed those points, I agree with him. However, as I said recently in the Chamber, following protests in South Uist, I will not prevaricate about the strain that is currently being felt in the network. Ongoing technical issues with vessels have resulted in delays to the annual overhaul programme, and cancellations of sailings have been the result of that. Now, regrettably, there are communities who have been more impacted by others, and I absolutely recognise the need to improve CalMac's reliability and rebuild confidence in services. Yeah, I'll briefly give way, but I've got a lot I'd like to get through.
Paul Sweeney.
Except that there are other fleets with similar vintages that operate with much greater resilience than in the CalMac fleet. Why is there not a proper total preventative maintenance system in place to ensure greater resilience of the fleet?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think that coming on the back, as Mr Sweeney's comments coming on the back of my full recognition of the need to improve CalMac's reliability and rebuild confidence in the fleet, should let him know that to some extent I agree that there is work to be done. So I deeply regret that island communities' needs have not always been met by CalMac services, that communication from them has not been always sufficient, it hasn't always been timorous. But much more than that, I don't just want to regret, I want to have a plan of action for how the government can do all that we can, all that is practicable, all that's in our gift to bolster reliability of the network. And as I see it, there's two principal parts of that. One is the action that we can take in the here and now to alleviate disruption in what is undeniably a period of pressure. And the second part of this for government is on making that period of pressure as short as possible by bolstering and adding to the numbers of vessels in the fleet. So I want to use the time I have today just to set out what the government's doing against both those objectives. Firstly, on the here and now, last week I met with the Chief Executive of CalMac, and my first question to CalMac management was how they intended to respond to the protests on South Uist. Because communication and presence in communities is, I think we all know as politicians, absolutely essential. If it's very brief, I will.
Rhoda Grant.
The Chamber would be interested to know how the government are going to respond to the demonstrations in South Uist rather than how CalMac...
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, once again, I have just started to address those two aspects of the government's plan on how what we will do in our gift to address this. So I'm not shying away at all from actions that the government needs to take, and I'm happy to narrate them now. But on the back of that meeting, I was very pleased to see that Mr Drummond visited South Uist and met with residents. This follows a similar visit from the former Minister for Transport in late May, and a visit that our new Transport Minister recently made in her committee capacity, and indeed those which I expect to make over the summer. As well as communication, CalMac management and I discussed the route prioritisation matrix, which CalMac used to assess options to maintain lifeline connections when there's disruption in the network. I ask that they urgently consider that route prioritisation matrix, making sure that it's fit for purpose and capable of taking into account cumulative impact and that cumulative impact on fragile island communities. And I expect the outcome of that in short order. This morning, I was pleased to meet with the Ferries Community Board. This board has community representatives from our islands and, in my view, is utterly invaluable as a source of lived experience. And I strongly believe that CalMac and Scottish Government should listen very carefully to what they have to say. I certainly intend to. Now, that is the response that we are undertaking the here and now. This motion is about compensation. I really don't have time, I'm afraid. I'm exceptionally short. We have a contract in place with CalMac through which we are able to make deductions, penalty deductions, when performance isn't met. And through that contract, penalties of between £1 million and £3 million per year have been recovered. Now, Michael Mara questioned where that funding has been directed. He need only look at the MV Alfred, which is currently providing resilience on the Arran route. That was part funded by these deductions at a cost of £9 million. It was part funded by the deductions, and it is providing resilience in the fleet. And I understand that that's exactly what islanders want most of all. I'm very conscious.
I'm sorry, I must ask the Cabinet Secretary to conclude.
I'm very conscious of time, Presiding Officer. And with that, I will leave it there and hope that my colleague, the Minister for Small Business, will cover any other points. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Graeme Simpson to speak to and move Amendment 9463.1.
Well, thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm afraid I didn't hear any kind of plan there. Can I thank Labour for bringing the debate to the Chamber, and we'll support their motion, of course, and I move the amendment in my name. Presiding Officer, in March, I welcomed Kevin Stewart to his new role as Transport Minister. He was just minutes into the job. Presiding Officer, I'm getting a bit of an echo when I speak here.
It's certainly the case that I'm content with what I can hear
I'll carry on. Audible sound. Mr. Stewart was just minutes into the job when I asked him an urgent question about what the government was doing to restore ferry services between Mallaig, Oban and Loch Boisdale in South Uist in light of the announcement that the services were to be withdrawn from 5th of April to 13th of May. He talked about recognising the challenges being faced and said the islands remained open for business. I then asked him if he would look at a compensation scheme and reduced fares for islanders. He said he would be speaking to CalMac that day and seek mitigations and solutions. Alistair Allen had another go on the idea of a business resilience fund, and he did slightly better. The minister said he would need to consider it further, which is not quite a commitment. Douglas Ross raised exactly the same issue last week, because 3 months on, things are no better. In fact, they're worse, with sailings of the MV Lord of the Isles between Mallaig and Loch Boisdale cancelled until the end of June. And locals, as we've heard, who protested in their hundreds, have said CalMac is ushering in a modern-day Highland clearances. CalMac uses something called a matrix to decide which services to run when there are problems, which is quite a lot of the time. John Daniel Petarana of the South Uist Business Ferry Impact Group, which organised the demonstration, said of the matrix, "It is as vague and woolly as you can get, and that is what they use to make decisions. It's hot air. We think it's commercially better for them to do this." He went on, "The matrix should look at the cultural and economic impact, but I cannot make any sense of the rubbish that has been written. We need an explanation of what it means. It's like the Highland clearances again." And CalMac's chief executive, Robbie Drummond, has been meeting islanders this week. Mr. Drummond had a taste of what they're going through when he reportedly couldn't get his car on the ferry and travelled a very long way around to get there. If it was Lorna Slater, of course, she would have just chartered a boat. Mr. Drummond has promised a review of the matrix, and we've heard that the Cabinet Secretary will do the same today. Presiding Officer, the upshot is this. People on the islands are suffering because of mismanagement of our ferries under the SNP. The government owns CMAL, which buys the boats and owns them. It also owns CalMac, which runs the ferries. And sitting above them is Transport Scotland and whoever is Minister of the day. The government even owns the yard, which is building two new ferries eventually. There's no one else to blame. The government is responsible. So when people are out of pocket because of them, they should be compensating them. It really is that simple. Right now, island life is being made a misery, so the government's amendment is quite shameful. It removes all mention of the compensation scheme. Any islander watching today will be furious. They're being let down, and now they're being ignored. So support my amendment and reject the government's.
Thank you. I now call on Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to note that transport's been restored to cabinet level and it should never have been removed. And I'd also like to take this opportunity to welcome Fiona Hislop to her new role as Transport Minister. Presiding Officer, I'd like to thank Michael Mara for bringing this important debate and motion to the Chamber this afternoon. Scottish Liberal Democrats will be supporting it at decision time as well as the Conservative Party amendment. It's the right thing to do to compensate islanders who have been left high and dry as a consequence of the Lifeline ferry service failing to meet their needs. The motion calls for resilience funding for compensation to come from penalties imposed on CalMac for breaches of its contract with Transport Scotland. The images of hundreds of people earlier this month in South Uist protesting about CalMac's decision to cancel most ferry sailings to Mallaig for the remainder of June will be a lasting image of the frustration at the Scottish Government's self-inflicted ferry fiasco. The thinking seems to be that the impact can be measured in numbers. It's a small community, small impact type of logic, when in fact the opposite is true. There's a disproportionately large impact on smaller communities. The missed hospital appointments, the missed weddings, the missed funerals, the loss of income when accommodation providers find bookings are cancelled because visitors can't get to the islanders, to the islands, or retailers have no stock. The threat to the island way of life. I welcome reports that CalMac will review their route prioritisation matrix. But the cynic in me would suggest that they're only doing so now because the islanders' demonstration hit national headlines. There is much that must be done to repair the damage and the trust. The hundreds protesting in South Uist, as Michael Mara observed, would equate to 180,000 people in Edinburgh if comparable numbers of cars were parked nose to tail to show disappointment at transport decisions affecting their lives. In the capital here, the government would not be able to ignore the chaos. The scale of protests in South Uist show the strength of feeling, that feeling of being isolated, trapped even, the sense of injustice from businesses facing losses. The anger at hearing the company at the heart of these issues is getting yet more taxpayer cash. There's a sense that the Scottish Government and Transport Scotland do not fully understand the needs of islanders and the critical connectivity, that interdependency. The SNP Green Government needs to look beyond the Central Belt. Island communities feel as though they've been abandoned. Depopulation is a serious concern in Scotland's islands and rural areas. The handling of this ferry fiasco and the lack of accountability by the government shows the concerns of islanders are distant to ministers. We face collapse of communities in island areas if ferries are not operating and services not improved. The response to the situation has shown that the government's response to depopulation is lip service at best. What's needed is long-term thinking about the ferry fleet capacity and resilience, a rolling plan for the replacement of old ferries, innovation in the build and needed functions, and a move away from thinking that impacts on island populations will be small. Islands and those who live there are very much part of Scotland. Geographically, culturally, socially, islanders are no less important than those who live on mainland Scotland. It's critical we get transport connectivity right, whether ferries, buses, or dare I say, tunnels, and everything else will fall into place. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. We move to the open debate, and I call Neil Bibby to be followed by Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome this important debate, and I speak in support of my Labour colleague Michael Mara's motion. As Michael Mara said, Scotland's islanders are right to be angry, dismayed, and frustrated because they simply do not have the ferry service they need or deserve. They have been failed and they have been let down. Given this and the recent and damaging disruption to island businesses in particular, it is only right that those businesses receive the compensation they need and deserve at this time. It's little wonder we have seen recent protests on South Uist, and we also know that anger and frustration is held in other islands across Scotland, including in Arran, in my own West Scotland region. I've spoken to businesses, particularly food producers, who are in despair. Delays to ferries cost them thousands of pounds a day and could cost jobs in the long term. But let's not talk around the key issue. Why are we here? The number one reason, the main reason by far, why islanders don't have a reliable ferry service is because CalMac does not have a reliable ferry fleet. In addition to it being unreliable, it is an ageing fleet with 38% of vessels over 30 years old and over the recommended lifespan for a ferry. This flies in the face of what the First Minister claimed last week about the SNP's investment in ferries. So let's look at the outcomes. Over the SNP's time in office, only 6 ferries have been built in 16 years. 6 in 16 years. Compare that to 10 ferries that were built by the previous Labour Liberal Democrat government in half that time. 8 years. 10 in 8 years. Even Margaret Thatcher's government built more new CalMac ferries than this current government. Your record is shameful. There's plenty of blame to go round here for this whole ferries fiasco, but the Scottish Government cannot blame anyone else for their abject failure to provide new ferries. Can't blame CalMac for that, certainly can't blame the Ferguson's workforce for that, and can't blame the previous government for their failures to provide decent ferries for our islands. And given this is the government's fault, then the least this government can do is now adequately compensate island businesses whose futures are at risk, and at real risk. It's time for the government to take responsibility. I say this because it appears day in, day out, the government is desperate not to take responsibility and to deflect blame elsewhere. To be clear, CMAL and CalMac are not entirely blameless, but it's not their job, and it's certainly not the job of their workers when dealing with angry passengers, to take the flak for this government's overall procurement failure. The Project Neptune report has been part of this deflection strategy. I do believe we need to look at how best governance and structures work and how we best run our ferries, but it cannot and must not distract us from the fact this government hasn't built enough ferries. One clear commitment, though, in relation to Project Neptune from the former Transport Minister was to rule out privatisation. It's hard to see how the current situation could be made worse, but privatisation of CalMac would do that. And that is something that should be ruled out by the new Transport Minister too. And in terms of taking responsibility, I wish the new Transport Minister, Fiona Hislop, and the new Transport Secretary, Mary McCallum, well, as I do Kevin Stewart. But I say to them what I said to Neil Gray last week, the ministerial merry-go-round needs to stop. There was a time when ministers couldn't get down to Ferguson's quick enough for a photo op, and now ministers can't wait to get ferries out of their portfolio and to buy themselves time with nice platitudes. Real responsibility would be a government minister standing up in this chamber and staking their reputation on fixing this mess and saying they won't leave until the job is done. Because of the current fiasco, we face a situation in which our ferry network is in crisis and we're having to build ferries in Turkey.
We're very tight for time, Mr Bibby, so okay. I must ask you to conclude.
Thank you. In closing, Presiding Officer, warm words from the government mean nothing and do nothing for island communities unless the government is willing to put its money where its mouth is and establish
you,
a proper
Bibby.
Resilience fund to compensate businesses. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
I call Alistair Allen to be followed by Jamie Green.
Presiding Officer, we all know and we've rehearsed today, quite rightly, the problems facing the CalMac network. There are not enough ships. The ships that are there are ageing. They are breaking down more often, and those repairs are taking longer. CalMac, once very much considered part of the fabric of life in the islands, does risk increasingly being seen by islanders as remote and bureaucratic. The continuing disruption has hit many businesses in my constituency hard, nowhere more so, I should say, than in Uist. Lough Boisdale is not typically a place where you will see protests and mass demonstrations. But the fact that, as others have pointed out, one-third of the island's resident population came out to demonstrate against the recent complete withdrawal of the ferry service says much about the pain being felt there. South Uist has suffered regularly from service disruption, and more, in fact, than anywhere else in the Clyde and Hebrides network. Over the course of a year, there were a total of 225 cancelled sailings versus 479 which operated. That is an astonishingly high cancellation rate, easily higher than anywhere else on the network. Winter was particularly bad, with only a quarter of scheduled sailings actually operating between November and March. Lifeline services should, in the first instance, serve island communities. And I preface the next remark carefully by acknowledging that every island in Scotland needs a good ferry service, but while other islands with smaller populations get two or even four vessel services, the whole string of islands from Eriskate to Bernary has to share half of a single ferry between North Uist and Skye at the moment. I will.
Donald Cameron.
I hear what he says about islands requiring ferries and how they differ in their capacities, but is it one of the most invidious things about this crisis is that sometimes islands are pitted against each other and that we have a sort of a really negative, almost a competition between islands, which should never happen.
Yeah. Alistair Allen.
Actually, identify with what the member says there, and that's why I tried to phrase my remarks carefully, because no, we shouldn't be in a position where islands are in competition with each other. Of course, when there are not enough ships, they inevitably are. But I point to the particular situation in South Uist, and my remarks, I hope, are clear about what they've been suffering. The focus on passenger numbers to the detriment of all other considerations is, I believe, seeing those running ferry or operating ferry services drift from their core purpose. And this is how we get to a route prioritisation matrix devised without any input from communities, which strips an island of all its ferry services for the whole month of June. I therefore welcome the Cabinet Secretary's remarks, in which she is, it would seem, willing to question this matrix. There is no lack of evidence, Presiding Officer, for the economic damage being caused. One example reported by Business Gateway in Uist detailed a 40% drop in bookings for accommodation providers. Hauliers who are not supported through compensation from CalMac have frequently faced, I must make progress now, have faced delay and rerouting over hundreds of miles. Time-critical shellfish exports have sometimes not been able to reach European markets timeously. But before the latest disruption even in Uist, businesses had approached me to say that they were not convinced that they could survive this year resulting from these issues. And of course, the complete withdrawal of the ferry service from South Uist makes that an even more critical situation. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government has rightly made ensuring a reliable ferry service a priority. We all want to see the new Isla-class vessels, as well as those at Port Glasgow, come into service. But as I hope I've illustrated, there are businesses across Uist which cannot afford to wait, and what is happening in Uist is in a different league to what is happening in many other places. The Government's amendment clearly recognises...
I must ask you to conclude, Mr Allen. I'm afraid that we have no extra time this afternoon.
Well, I conclude there and recognise that the Government amendment goes some way, in fact, a great deal of the way, to acknowledging those problems,
thank you,
which are very real.
Thank you. I call Jamie Green to be followed by Katie Clark.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to do something unusual with my 4 minutes. I'd like to nominate one of our constituents for an award. His letter was dubbed Letter of the Day, but I would like to nominate Mr. John S. Milligan from Kilmarnock, the prestigious parliamentary award of Letter of the Year, because it brilliantly sums up this entire debate. Let me read his letter to you. Dear Editor, I booked my car and caravan onto the Ardrossan Brodick ferry about 2 months ago for one of my several annual holiday trips to the Isle of Arran. Regrettably, CalMac has cancelled my booking with just over a week before the trip was scheduled to take place. CalMac, trying to be helpful, has advised that I can still travel to Arran via Clonig, which is fine because whilst it is a four-hour trip from my home, I know the route like the back of my hand since I've had to travel it so often due to last-minute cancellations. So why do I want to raise my latest holiday ferry booking problem? Quite simply, I am utterly fed up with the lottery operated by CalMac, which leaves travellers to Scottish islands in the position where they are unable to guarantee whether they can either reach or return from their chosen destination on the dates booked. Now, I might lose out on a holiday, which in the overall scheme of things is a relatively minor issue, says Mr. Milligan. But perhaps more importantly, the long-suffering island communities will also lose out. For example, Janie's Cafe, just outside Brodick, will not be serving me or my other seven members of my family lunch. Neither will the Coffee Pot in Whiting Bay. The Lochranza caravan site will not be getting our booking. The Stag Pavilion in Lochranza will not be serving us dinner. Pern Mill Stores, along with numerous others, will not receive our custom. And all of these businesses, which need a reliable ferry service to exist, are significantly disadvantaged by the mess that is our so-called island ferry services. Now, he says, I don't know whether to blame CalMac or the Scottish Government. I don't know who is to blame, but what I do know is that the current situation cannot continue with its current hit-and-miss approach. This, he goes on, would be an ideal time for our new First Minister to show that although under the previous regime which he was part of and unable to successfully build ships on time, he can now successfully deliver projects on time for the people of Scotland. I hope the First Minister was listening to John's letter, because he is right. Businesses on Arran, as they are elsewhere, are at their utter wit's end due to this endless uncertainty. Many are unsure if they will even survive this crisis. Last year, I raised in the Chamber the Ochrani Resort, which wrote off £400,000 into their cash flow to account for ferry disruption. And that's on top of another £300,000 in related costs. And that's just one island, one business. Multiply that by hundreds of businesses on dozens of islands. You don't need to be the finance secretary to do the math on that. It all adds up. The problem is we don't know by how much. And when I asked the Scottish Government just an hour ago if they had done any work whatsoever to calculate the potential economic cost of this crisis to our island communities, and I say this with the greatest respect to Mr. Lockhead, who I have a lot of time for personally, it was complete waffle in response. And we heard that repeated, I'm afraid, from the Cabinet Secretary again today. They do not know the answer because they probably do not want to know the answer of the immense cost of this. Our islands need compensation, and they needed it yesterday. No ifs or buts. Get a move on.
I call Katie Clark to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Sir, for giving me this opportunity to speak, particularly on behalf of constituents on the Clyde Islands of Arran and Cumbrae, who, like thousands of others, are regularly impacted by the ongoing ferry crisis, which is causing chaos. As we all know, when a ferry breaks down on a lifeline route, it affects islanders' ability to attend hospital appointments, work, funerals, and a wide range of other commitments on the mainland, and others' ability to visit the island. The declining resilience of CalMac ferries has an impact on almost every aspect of island life and the economies of island communities, and has a disproportionate impact on those producing goods with short shelf lives, and indeed on those trying to buy or indeed sell such goods with short shelf lives, such as food. So over the festive period, many constituents were in touch with myself and no doubt others in the chamber about the empty food shelves in shops on Arran due to ferry cancellations. And unfortunately, this is becoming a regular occurrence. Constituents on Cumbrae have been in touch about problems with postal services, as well as many other items, as a result of the problems with the ferry service there. So in both Arran and Cumbrae, significant problems have been caused by the failure of CalMac to give priority to essential goods such as food, and indeed, yes, I'm happy to give
Cabinet Secretary.
For the member for taking an intervention. Just as she rightly narrates the concerns of her constituents, I just wonder if she can welcome, in the context of Michael Mara's motion, the fact that the MV Alfred, part funded by CalMac penalty deductions, is now serving her constituents, who I know have concerns on Arran.
Katie Clark.
Anything that's done to alleviate the current situation, but as the Cabinet Secretary well knows, islanders on Arran are continuing to have significant problems. However, I was focusing on a very specific issue that's been raised by islanders who are asking that priority is given to essential goods such as food and indeed on postal services, as there are repeated problems with such essentials when ferries are cancelled. And I suspect, I know I've written to the Cabinet Secretary and her previous colleagues in her role about this issue, and I suspect others have as well. CalMac's own social economic report from 2020 showed their services generated over £227 million in turnover with a footprint of over £350 million. A 2020 North Ayrshire Council Fraser of Allender report estimated that on average each day of ferry operation, there is a contribution of just under £170,000 to Arran's economy. And of course, that figure will be greater now. So there is absolutely no doubt that the impact of functioning lifeline ferry services has a significant impact on the economies of island communities and cannot be underestimated. We know that tourism businesses estimate they lose tens of thousands of pounds every time one of the two ferries serving Arran is diverted to support services elsewhere. Labour's motion today insists that the Scottish Government establish a resilience fund to help businesses affected by CalMac cancellations. Islanders are in this situation because of the decisions of politicians that have meant that we have not procured the vessels needed over many years, and I hope that Parliament will support this motion today.
Thank you. I call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Ariane Burgess.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First of all, I'd like to remind the Chamber that my wife works part-time for CalMac. I'd also like to welcome Fiona Hislop to her new role in the Scottish Government, and also the new responsibility that the Cabinet Secretary has for transport also. Presiding Officer, this debate is timely, and I do want to put on record my considerations for the local MSP Alistair Allen and his representations to the Scottish Government for his constituents. That, like all constituency MSPs, our first priority is to our constituents, and that is what Alistair Allen has consistently done throughout this particular situation. Nobody is in doubt of the significant distress and difficulty that ferry disruption has had on island communities and the economies. When you have a reported third of the community demonstrating to highlight their plight, it's obvious that there is a problem that needs to be addressed. On the fair question of compensation, the Scottish Government is carefully considering the best option for the resilience of island economies. And the compensation fund has not been introduced for the reason that money is already deducted from CalMac in penalties and fines and reinvested back into the resilience of the network. The chartering of the MV Alfred from Pendleton Ferries, for example, has been part-funded by CalMac's performance deductions. The First Minister actually highlighted this at First Minister's questions very recently. And the motion from the opposition talks about the funds. Now, the challenge with this is where the money would actually come from, as the penalties are already being reinvested back into the system. Now, certainly, CalMac removing a service for 1 month at the busiest time of the year is certainly not going to be positive for the South Uist economy. And I know that Alistair Allen has previously written to the Scottish Government expressing the concerns and issues of his constituents and also the local businesses accordingly. President Officer, I accept that CalMac, CIMAL and the Scottish Government are facing a massive challenge when faced with this present situation. Indeed, CIMAL is on record as having looked at and also considered over 650 ships over a 5-year period to actually bring into the fleet. In addition,
the Scottish Government has bought and deployed an additional vessel in the MV Lough Fraser, chartered MV Arrow to provide additional resilience and capacity, made significant progress in the construction of vessels 801 and 802, commissioned two new vessels for Islay, commissioned two new vessels for the Little Minch routes, progressed investment in key ports and harbours, and confirmed additional revenue funding for the operation of local authority inter-island ferry services. The investment in ports and harbours is hugely important, and the job that CMAL are undertaking here is absolutely vital to help provide the public ferry service network that I'm sure that actually we all want to see. The Minister's amendment highlights a few areas that I believe are important in this debate, and the part in the amendment that I believe is crucial, and that is, and I quote, an address concerns that have been raised around CalMac's route prioritisation matrix to ensure that it is reviewed with input from communities and that it considers the economic impact to fragile island communities. For one area to be the go-to location with regular occurrence from CalMac to see a reduced service is, in my opinion, wrong. There clearly needs to be a wide range of factors involved in this matrix, and the review of these are absolutely imperative. So the quicker this happens, the better. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I want to see our ferry service improve, and the sooner the additional ferries come onto the fleet, the better, and they will certainly help with the resilience in the service. But the immediate priority must be to help Uist. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Ariane Burgess, to be followed by Donald Cameron.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to welcome my colleague Fiona Hislop to her new role as Minister for Transport. As a Highlands and Islands MSP, I hear from and feel the profound impact that ferry disruption has on my constituents. It's vital to centre them in this debate and in all our plans to improve ferry services. Our islands are not museums or amusement parks for tourists. They are living, breathing communities with ferries as their vital arteries. And every council ferry trip for islanders is an appointment missed, a job unfinished, or a shop unstocked. While the value of the fines paid by CML have been used partly fund the cost of the charter of MV Alfred, these funds are not nearly sufficient to address the challenges faced by businesses and communities on our islands. And situations like that faced by those in South Uist must be prevented, and that must be our focus now. A short-term resilience fund is not a sustainable solution to the systemic issue causing the challenges in our islands. I'm not going to take an inventory. You hear that we're short for time. At best, this would be a temporary and repackaged form of a short-term relief that would prioritise the disruption caused to business, not the disruption caused to communities. Why should a business be compensated for a cancelled booking and not a constituent who has missed a hospital appointment or a long-planned family gathering? Instead, the Scottish Government's budget must be directed to substantial investment in our future ferry services that addresses the root causes of the challenges being faced by our island communities. We need legislation and funding that will revitalise our islands in the round, such as the Community Wealth Building Bill, of which the Western Isles Council is currently engaged in a pilot project, and the funding that Scottish Greens have been calling for to support community-led housing and development projects, such as those on Mull, Collinsey and Gia. As you heard, I will not take an intervention because the presiding officer said we are tight on time. Rather than simply handing over small amounts of money to affected businesses, as Labour is proposing, we should fundamentally change the way economies operate in our island communities so that public and private funds are retained and optimised. It is crucial that we unlock the potential of our island communities and help them reverse depopulation trends by delivering a resilient ferry network to support Scotland's future as a thriving island nation. As long as the Scottish Government's finances are constrained by a defective devolution settlement and routinely worsened by UK Government austerity and Tory economic mismanagement, it's hard to see what viable route there is to further increase is to spending on our ferry services and infrastructure. Spending that has increased by 180% since last year, delivering new vessels and supporting improved piers, harbours and to future-proof our ferry fleet. I continue to urge that new vessels be low carbon, like the electric ferries running on renewable energy in Sweden and Denmark. We also need to decarbonise our existing vessels, retrofitting electric motors, cut pollution, emissions, noise and running costs. We must also urgently advance a review of fares to ensure island communities are not further disadvantaged. And in closing, Presiding Officer, as the RMT called for yesterday, all parties need to join together constructively to support CalMac, CMAL and our island stakeholders to get round the table and to design a long-term solution.
Thank you. I call Donald Cameron to be followed by Ivan McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I also begin by welcoming Fiona Hislop to her role as Transport Minister? She undoubtedly comes into that position with significant experience in government, and that is desperately needed at this time. One of the problems has been that there has been no Transport Minister in place long enough to understand the problems and commit to solving them. And as Neil Bibby said, there has been a ministerial merry-go-round, I think. Merry-go-round were his words. In all the years that I have been in place as an MSP, never before has the crisis engulfing Scotland's ferry network been as great a danger to island life as it is now. We have spoken many times about island depopulation and the need to address the challenges that cause it, including fixing the unreliable ferry network. But words can only do so much. We need urgent action, and so far this government has failed in every metric. The number of cancellations has been growing. The number of ferry breakdowns has been growing. And earlier this year we learned that CalMac is on track to break its own level of performance fines. This does not instill any confidence in the Scottish Government's ability to get a grip on this crisis. And to Arianne Burgess, I say this. She found time to blame the UK Government, but the blame here sits with the Scottish Government and the Scottish Government alone. And for once, I ask her to stand up for the island communities she represents. Because the situation is desperate and it is affecting residents, visitors and businesses on a daily basis. In the short term that I want to focus my contribution on one island which has been so badly affected in recent weeks and months, and that is Mull. And the really sad thing is that I could pick almost any island on the Western Seaboard whose community has been affected by this crisis. But Mull has seen its ferry services dwindle following the redeployment of the MV Isle of Mull, and in its place two smaller vessels that are unable to cope with demand, especially as the summer season swings into place. The lack of a like-for-like vessel to serve Mull has resulted in 250 fewer car spaces, 7,000 fewer passenger spaces every day. Coupled with the disastrous new booking system launch, this has meant that bookings have been cancelled at short notice and passengers forced into a free-for-all. And it has a direct impact on the people living and working on Mull. I spoke to one local business owner, Stephen Blasey, who runs Mull Wildlife Breaks. He told me he offers customers a bespoke wildlife holiday, but it is becoming increasingly difficult to satisfy clients when their pre-booked tickets are disregarded by CalMac and they just have to get onto any boat they can be slotted onto. He says that this crisis is resulting in a downturn in bookings and cancellations are being received at an alarming rate. Another business, the Tobermory Bakery and Tea Room, has reportedly lost between 30 to 40% of its usual takings as a result of coach tour cancellations. Local groups, such as the Mull Rugby Club, have been hit hard. It organised a rugby tournament a month or so ago and spent £12,000 on catering and equipment, only to be told by several clubs visiting the island that CalMac had cancelled their bookings. Or the Mull junior sporting competitor, who had two qualifiers in her sport to represent an under-18 Scotland team and was uncertain about whether she could actually get off the island to attend. Presiding Officer, the situation in Mull and across all of Scotland's islands is reaching a precipice. Of all the groups I referred to, and many, many others more, they need urgent support. Warm words about investment in resilience, as important as that is, simply won't cut it. So I've asked this of Hamza Youssef, I've asked Kevin Stewart, I've asked Mary McCallan, and I now ask Fiona Hislop. We need a ferry compensation scheme right now, and that is why we will be supporting Labour's motion at decision time.
Thank you. And I call Ivan McKee, the final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd just like to start by welcoming Fiona Hislop
to her role as Transport Minister. The importance of ferries to island business is a critical part of Scotland's tourism sector. And I'd like to address my remarks to impacts on the sector, following on in large part from the debate we had on tourism last week. And in that vein, I'd like to congratulate Minister Richard Lockhead for getting tourism back into his title, which is hugely important and significant step. In the context of the Scottish tourism sector bouncing back very strongly, as it has done in the post-COVID, with international visitors in particular, that, of course, is a hugely key part of Scotland's economy, as we reflected on last week, far beyond the bounds of the tourism sector itself. But while that whole supply chain doesn't work, of course, if visitors can't get to Scotland's islands, so what is happening and the detriment and impact it's having on tourism in Scotland's islands, impacting the broader tourism sector across Scotland and impacting Scotland's the vision of Scotland more broadly internationally is hugely significant. So I want to focus my remarks on the impact on local businesses, tourism, but also food and drink, with some examples of costs that businesses have incurred as I proceed through my remarks. But it's important to note that this isn't just about the immediate impact when ferries are cancelled at short notice, but the cumulative impact that it has on confidence in the sector, and it hurts not just local tourism, but of course the whole sector as it diminishes Scotland's tourism offer. Very quickly.
Michael Murray.
I thank the member for giving way. Does he agree with his Green Party colleagues in the disregard they show for businesses who employ people in these islands and who vitally need this support?
Ivan McKee.
Recognised, of course it does. That uncertainty is damaging. For example, tour operators now taking decisions to delist islands from the 2024 tour itineraries to protect their reputation because of the uncertainty they have around ferry connectivity. And it must be mentioned also problems with the new booking system, which is adding to these difficulties have been highlighted. And there's many other examples where the knock-on effects hurt businesses beyond those lost revenues. Visitors claiming back costs, raising a dispute with credit card companies, leading to more work, bureaucracy and additional costs for businesses. Businesses that are having to buy and are buying in quality fresh seafood and other produce, which they then can't use when guests have to cancel at short notice, that food going to waste. Lost potential businesses, visitors thinking about coming to visit our islands, but that uncertainty leading to them cancelling or not booking at all and going elsewhere, often outside of Scotland. And of course, it must be recognised that businesses don't make as much noise about this as they might due to their fears about damaging the image of the industry and jeopardising future bookings. There's many examples I could cite of this. A small independent gin company, £15,000 down in revenue for May and June in the distillery. Family-run boutique, bed and breakfast, 1 week's loss is more than £9,000, all due to lack of ferries being cancelled, each one resulting in endless paperwork and phone calls with some very disgruntled customers. And another accommodation provider, total lost earnings over a six-month period, £24,500. Their last inquiry booking was on the 4th of April, and they've not had any further inquiry since, all a consequence of that uncertainty across the sector. So I welcome the fact the government takes this seriously. I welcome the fact there's three ministers here to address the issue, and I have every confidence we'll work together to do that right across the whole range of things that need to be dealt with. And the final point, I think it's worth reflecting on the fact that investing in that network is not just something to do because it supports island communities, important as that is. It's an investment in Scotland's economy. It generates returns through building the tourism sector, making it more productive and increasing the tax base, not on the on the islands, but right across Scotland, the whole economy, and enhancing Scotland's overall
you must
reputation
conclude, Mr. McKee.
As a destination. So thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. We move to winding up speeches, and I call on Jamie Halker-Johnston.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to Labour for bringing this debate to the Chamber today, and as an islander, I'm pleased to be able to speak on an area of real concern for island communities across Scotland. It's been an interesting debate, but while the impact of the ferries crisis on island communities has been well raised by many across this Chamber, I think islanders will note with disappointment how many SNP and Green MSPs chose to put defending their government before standing up for islanders and island businesses. I've warned time and time again that the ferries crisis engulfing Scotland's west coast risks spreading further. There is a ticking time bomb not only in the existing CalMac fleet, but also in those boats which provide lifeline links for the Northern Isles. The Hamnavo, Hrossi and Hjaltland are all now 20 years old. And in Orkney, our inter-island boats are even older, the Thorfinn, Sigurd and Varagon, all over 30 years old. These are owned and operated by Orkney Islands Council, but it's quite clear that the increasing urgency in planning replacement vessels is necessary and that the Council will need support doing so. And the same is true in Shetland, but as ever, the Scottish Government has been slow to engage. And while talks are now underway, as they are in Orkney, there is still no commitment to help. But these are vital links for our island communities, and I'll remind the Chamber of the words of Shetland Council Convener Emma MacDonald, who, commenting on the UK Government's grant of £27 million of levelling up funding for a new ferry and new terminals for the Fair Isles, said, and I quote, "It's no exaggeration to say that this funding from the UK Government has saved Fair Isle as an island inhabited island. There would have been no other way for us to sustainably fund such a project. The UK Government acted where the Scottish Government wouldn't." Yeah. And it's not just our island communities that are suffering. The Coronarius crossing is one of Scotland's busiest, but this vital link has been severed for months, with the route's main vessel delayed, returning from refit, and its 47-year-old replacement breaking down almost immediately. This is a service operated by Highland Council, but with no real encouragement from the Scottish Government forthcoming, that council, now run by the SNP, has chosen to apply to the UK Government for levelling up funding. Local communities on the Ardnamurchan Peninsula, desperate for a reliable service, will now be hoping the UK Government steps up, again where Scottish ministers haven't. So in welcoming Fiona Hislop as the new Transport Minister to her role, which I do, and I genuinely do wish her all the very best in this new role, because communities across my region can't afford for her to fail as others have, I would ask her that she commits to meet with communities in Ardnamurchan, and unlike her last two predecessors, actually delivers on that commitment. Presiding Officer, if I can turn very briefly to the Scottish Government's motion, one which is full of platitudes but misses one vital word, sorry. Scottish ministers have again heralded the £1 million per month deal to charter the MV Alfred from Pentland Ferries. What they don't mention is that the vessel covering the Pentland-Firth route while the Alfred is away, the MV Pentelina, suffered a major failure and only returned to service yesterday after 6 weeks out, leaving Orkney without our short sea route for all that time. It wasn't in peak season, and so the impact has, it appears, been minimal, largely because of the efforts of Northlink to step in. But it's clear, as I've mentioned, that the crisis on the West Coast is now impacting other island communities. And that crisis risks only getting worse until new vessels come into service in any significant numbers. And I welcome any acceleration in the replacement of major vessels, but it shouldn't have taken 16 years, and the desperate situation of its own making the Scottish Government finds itself in now, for the SNP to make this a priority. In the meantime, island communities will continue to suffer, and by refusing to provide compensation, the SNP appears content to abandon local businesses and islanders to their fate. And that is shameful, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call on Minister Richard Lockhead.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I also begin by welcoming Fiona Hislop to her new role as Transport Minister? If there's anyone who's going to work tirelessly to address the issues that have been raised today, the very serious issues that have been raised today, it's Fiona Hislop, working alongside Cabinet Secretary Mary McCallum as well. And I actually think it's a very, very important debate, because it's really important that all our island communities see this National Parliament discussing the very real challenges they face, many of which are a result of the disruption to ferry services, which, of course, is the subject of this particular debate. I think, you know, Katie Clark, Ivan McKee, Beatrice Wishart, and, of course, Alistair Allen have all illustrated very clearly the very real impact on everyday lives of people living and working in the islands when there's disruption to ferry services. I'll give way.
Jamie Hilker-Johnston.
Islanders have seen this Parliament debating this issue time and time again. What they haven't seen is ferries. What they haven't seen is action from this Scottish Government. And that's what they're angry about.
Minister.
Well, there are six new ferries that's been discussed coming into service in the next few years, and that will make a huge difference and represents very, very significant investments, as does indeed the £2.2 billion that's been invested in ferry services since 2007 by this Government. But I just want to say that while we have a variety of different opinions Today, the Parliament is clearly united in wanting to support our island communities. I'm running out of time, but I'll take one final, given it's...
Michael Marr.
I do appreciate that the Minister giving way. And he mentions the ferries that have been constructed. Doesn't he recognise that the businesses are at risk now and the livelihoods that are supported by those businesses and the wages going into pockets? That's what we're asking for, support now, not waiting for six ferries that may be built sometime in the future.
Minister.
I do recognise that, and I want to come on to that, because all ministers of the Scottish Government, like people across the chamber, very much recognise the strength of feeling on the islands that was illustrated, for instance, by the very powerful protest in Uist, and clearly others have given many illustrations of the impact on businesses in all different sectors, the food and drink industry, tourism, of course, and they're very real examples of the impact this situation is having on the economy in our islands. And it's really important that this government recognises our responsibility and the fact that we're accountable and we get this right for people who do live in the islands, and we take that responsibility very, very, very seriously. And we are, of course, committed to working closely with regional and local partners, including local government, to make sure we've got regional economic empowerment. But to realise that ambition, island businesses and communities do need reliable and resilient connectivity, including ferry services and digital connectivity. And the First Minister said in this chamber just last Thursday, that we are looking at what more we can do to support businesses. He also said in the same contribution that nothing is off the table. So I think it's really important to send out the message today to our island communities. Minister, Scottish Government, Parliament is listening. This is a very serious issue facing some communities, and we are listening and we will act.
The Minister has 40 seconds.
Sorry, I can't take the intervention. So we are investing heavily in our island communities. There were some wider references to the priority of supporting our island communities. £26 million committed to the National Islands Plan, £4.1 million this year. £50 million towards the island's growth deal. 16 new subsea cables to 15 islands through the R100 North contracts. The Small Business Bonus Scheme, the Rural Rates Relief Scheme, and we're committed to a rural development plan as well. And I could go on and on and on. So that investment is extremely important, as is sorting out the ferry services and getting the investment right as well. We've been speaking to communities about the impact of that. And the final point I just want to make, Presiding Officer, is for the Tories to talk about others not standing up for island communities, when the UK Government announced £4.8 billion for levelling up, not one penny's gone to the Western Isles, and virtually not one penny's gone to all the other island communities in Scotland. So the Conservative Party could also stand up for island communities moving forward as well. In the meantime, this government is committed to sorting this issue out and standing by our island communities.
Thank you. And I call on Rhoda Grant to wind up the debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I too welcome Fiona Hislop to her new post. And I sincerely wish her every success in it, because people's lives really depend on her being successful in sorting out this debacle. Island businesses don't want compensation, they want ferries. But without ferries, they need help to survive. And that's why they're asking for the Scottish Government to set up a resilience fund. And we agree with them. We're not asking for the Scottish Government to cut spending elsewhere to do that. We're asking them to pay for it with the very fines that they charge CalMac when ferries are not running. Surely that's natural justice, that those who bear the brunt of the cancellations should receive those fines.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm grateful to Rhoda Grant for taking an intervention. On that basis, does Rhoda Grant believe that those penalties should not be reinvested into vessels like the MV Alfred currently providing resilience in the network?
Rhoda Grant.
The Cabinet Secretary keeps flagging the MV Alfred as their contribution to this. Can I say they are spending £1 million a month on renting the MV Alfred, £9 million for 9 months. That's a ferry that cost £14 million to buy. This is ridiculous. The Scottish Government bear responsibility for this crisis, and it lies squarely at their door. It's not the fault of CalMac or their staff, because they don't build ferries. It's the fault of the Scottish Government, who failed to build them, and when they did try, were proven absolutely incompetent. Neil Bibby said they've built 6 ferries in 16 years. Compare that with the 10 built in the 8 years of the Liberal Labour coalition. And even Margaret Thatcher built more ferries than the SNP. And sadly, those ageing ferries are still being used on these routes. So the Cabinet Secretary and the Minister are responsible for the inaction of their government because they can't pass the buck. And of course, some islands are impacted more than others. South Uist, as Michael Mara said, where 1 in 4 sailings is disrupted. But there is not a single island that hasn't been unscathed, as Neil Bibby said. And that is having a huge personal cost to communities. Beatrice Wishart talked about funerals missed, weddings missed. Cancer treatment is also missed. Katie Clark talked about food and essential provisions being impacted in Arran and the Cumbries. Donald Cameron talked about Mull. Ivan McKee reeled off a huge number of issues. There is not an island that is not impacted by all of this. But South Uist is a case in point and stands out. The local community, the local economy loses £50,000 a day in low season for lost ferries. They have lost millions in the last couple of months. And South Uist was a growing community. Young families were being welcomed back. Storist Uist, the community landowner, was developing the area. Keolis, the language and culture centre, was becoming a focal point for the whole community. It was community empowerment in action, and yet they have been marooned by this Scottish government. A third of the population out protesting against that, and yet the best they can get from the Scottish Government is a review of the matrix. Very briefly.
Jamie Green.
Can I thank Rhona Grant? I don't know if Islanders on Uist will be as angry and frustrated having listened to today's debate, and not a single ounce of detail has come from the government benches on what compensation might be available to them and their businesses. Not a single word or commitment from this government, and they will be as fuming as we are on this side of the chamber.
Rhona Grant.
Yes, I can only imagine that people are getting angrier by the day as they wait and see no action being taken at all. Because everyone is impacted. A haulier told us, be it a toothbrush or a new built house, you have to get that on island and it has to come by ferry. Alistair Allens talked about the 40% of bookings dropped for accommodation. That's almost half an annual income gone. Keolis, who I talked about before, their summer school has been impacted because bookings are well down, and that's got a knock-on effect to the local community as well. And a haulier told us, people can't make a living. They can't stay here. Presiding officer, the impact of this impacts on staff as well, because they have to bear the brunt of community frustration, and that is simply not right. They were once proud to serve their islands, and that has been taken away from them.
You must conclude, Ms Grant.
I will, presiding officer. When the government makes a mistake, it compensates people. It did during COVID when people were losing their businesses. They need to do that now because the impact of this is worse than COVID. They need to build ferries, they need to set up a resilience fund, and they need to do right by our communities.
Thank you.